Alright. I think we're going to get started. Thanks so much for being here. Very excited to have all of you be here. Welcome to Decoded. This is our second session in a series of sessions that are particularly about learning more about technology in the public benefit space. So thanks so much for being here. You don't need any technical experience to be here, and I appreciate your time. My name is Simone Singleton. I use she, they pronouns. I'm a digital services analyst at CBPP. My email's there. If you have any questions, you want to reach out later. Very excited for today. Throughout today's session, if you have any questions, feel free to drop them in the chat. My co-host, Elizabeth, will keep an eye on it. I'll keep an eye on it. And if we miss anything, feel free to raise your hand or just, you know, come off mute or come off camera. You're welcome to be on camera or off camera, up to you. And at the end of the session, we will send out a PDF of all the slides. So you'll be able to see those and share them as you see fit. All right, cool. So we have an agenda for today. I'm going to go through some introductions, and then we'll walk through a number of really interesting key terms, do some level setting about digital identity in the public benefit space. We'll give you an introduction to digital identity standards, and then an overview of the landscape, what's happening in the country. And then we'll have an opportunity for discussion at the end. We'll work through a Jamboard, putting virtual sticky notes on the board. And hear what you guys have to say, what you've been experiencing. Cool. Elizabeth, you want to hop in?
Yeah, thanks so much, Simone. My name is Elizabeth Bynum Sorrell. My pronouns are she, her, and I'm a researcher with the Digital Benefits Network at the Beck Center for Social Impact and Innovation at Georgetown University. The Digital Benefits Network, or the DBN for short, supports government in delivering public benefits services and technology that are accessible, effective, and equitable in order to ultimately increase economic opportunity. And we work across key benefits programs, including food and nutrition programs, health programs, cash assistance, childcare, and unemployment insurance to identify shared challenges and opportunities and amplify strategies to enable equitable and effective implementation. At the DBN, we explore current and near-term challenges while also creating space to envision future policies, services, and technologies. Much of my research since I joined the DBN in mid-2022 has been focused on digital identity in public benefits. So I'm super excited to be here today to have the opportunity to chat with all of you and also to really learn from some of your experiences in your states. I'll pass back to you, Simone.
I'm back. Hello. Thank you so much. We're going to walk through some stuff, and Elizabeth and I are going to be going back and forth. So buckle up. We're going to have some fun. Cool. So today we're specifically focused on digital identity in the public benefit space. People in the public benefit space will likely interact with online services that may ask them to prove their identity or create an account at some point. It's become increasingly common during and after the pandemic, especially in the unemployment insurance space. And services like ID.me have received big contracts. However, sometimes the rollouts have led to access concerns. And unnecessary digital identity requirements can cause barriers for folks. And so it's important for us to consider the questions of how can we improve the digital identity landscape and what is useful background information for us to know when making decisions in this space. So we're going to walk through a few key terms. I won't read them all out to you right now because we're about to walk through them. But this is just an overview of what the kind of terms we're going to be touching on today. Elizabeth?
Yeah, thanks. So I think it's important to have a little grounding in, like, what are we talking about when we're talking about digital identity? At the highest level, when we're using the word digital identity or the term, we're talking about like how we can tell someone else or a service provider like a government agency or a bank information about who we are online. The National Institute of Standards and Technology, or NIST, also shout out to my colleague from NIST who is in the audience today. And we'll be talking more about NIST in a little while. But NIST defines digital identity as the unique representation of a person engaged in an online transaction. But I think it's important to put that in context. So when you want to access a service online, you might need to create a specific digital identity. For example, you might make a username or an account to place an online shopping order. That username or account represents you when you interact with that retailer online. And we also might represent ourselves online in multiple distinct ways. So think for a moment about the number of accounts you have across the internet. Importantly, creating an account or username doesn't mean that a service provider knows who you are in the real world. And when a service provider wants to know who someone is IRL, they may use processes of identity proofing and authentication. So let's spend a little bit of time talking about what identity proofing and authentication are as we get into some of our key terms. You can go to the next slide. Oh, perfect. Thanks, Simone. So identity proofing, putting this into real world context again, many of us in this Zoom room have likely encountered identity proofing prompts. This might look like sharing information about yourself, like your name, your address, your social security number, and then answering questions about your credit history. It might also look like prompts to upload an image of your face, like a selfie, and a photo ID. Identity proofing, though, kind of at the highest level, is a process through which a credential service provider collects, validates, and verifies information about a person. When I'm using the term credential service provider here, talking about the party that is issuing that identity proofing determination. And that could be a bank, a government agency, or a third party that's actually conducting that process. Identity proofing is basically used to establish confidence that someone is who they claim to be. And if it's being used, it's usually happening when someone accesses a service or a system for the first time or is like enrolling in that process. You might have also seen this referred to as identity verification, but identity proofing is technically a three-step process, and verification is just one piece of that, as you can see on this very fun graphic that I borrowed from some of NIST digital identity guidelines materials. You may have also heard the term remote identity proofing to talk about this process in some cases. We'll talk more about how identity proofing shows up in public benefits applications and systems in a moment. But whether or not you're being asked to go through identity proofing to access a system, you might still have to create an account to access a service or come back to it later, which brings us to authentication. So in more technical terms, authentication determines the validity of one or more authenticators used to claim a digital identity. But basically, authentication is how a service provider tries to confirm that someone accessing an account is the same person each time. So you might be using different kinds of authenticators to demonstrate that you are that in control of that account and are the right person who should be accessing it. Those might look like things you know, like a password or a PIN. It might be something you have, like a one-time passcode that's sent to a device you have access to, or a cryptographic key. It could also mean something you are, like biometric information, like a fingerprint, or an image of your face. But once you've established a username or other login credentials with a service, you're authenticating your access when you return to that service, for example, by entering a password or inputting an authentication code via text to confirm that you have access to that account or system. I think it's really important to emphasize that while establishing a secure digital identity can foster trust between a user and a service provider, in some cases, it can also create barriers or friction for users. In the benefits delivery context, many benefits applications or case management portals that don't necessarily require identity proofing may require users to have an account and be authenticating that. So how well that account creation and authentication process works for users can be a really important equity and access question. And for both identity proofing and authentication, the choice to use those processes and the level of complexity for both should depend on the risk context for a given system or service. So services or systems that don't hold sensitive data might not need the same level of security. And we're going to talk a lot more about some of those trade-offs in a moment. But I will pass back to you, Simone.
Appreciate it. Sorry, I didn't mean to jump the slide too early. Cool. So as Elizabeth has mentioned, there are a number of ways people might interact with identity proofing or authentication. In the benefit space, there are kind of two primary lanes, which is either during an online application or when accessing a case management portal after you've applied. So I, Simone Singleton, am applying for benefits in California. Let's say it's SNAP. How do I access this application online? In general, the recommendation is that there is no, or our recommendation is that there is no proofing before application. It can be a significant barrier to people. And for the most part, they are only submitting their information. They're not accessing private information that might need to be protected. There's also a world where we are accessing a case management portal after we've been approved for benefits. And in this world, there may be some authentication or proofing necessary because private information can be accessed once you've logged in. So for example, I log in, I might be able to see an address, I might be able to see work history, things like that. In general, the status quo in the space is if information is being returned from a confidential data source, then some type of proofing is necessary. What we'll touch on in a second is there are a number of ways to approach proofing, and it's not a one-size-fits-all solution, and it's important for us to consider the risks, consequences, and benefits of each solution as we move forward. I dropped this in the chat, but if you have any questions, we moved past something too fast, feel free to ask your questions or ask us to slow down. All right. So one form of identity proofing is biometric. In the context of identity, biometrics refers to automated recognition of individuals based on their biological and or behavioral characteristics. So there are some common forms of biometrics, such as face recognition technology, fingerprinting, or voice recognition. If you have a phone like an iPhone and you use your fingerprint or face ID to unlock it, that's a form of biometrics you might be familiar with. Another form might be services like ID.me, where you have to upload a picture of yourself and that visual, your face is matched to something else. There are equity and security concerns when it comes to biometrics that we should keep in mind when applying this as a solution. First off, under the equity umbrella is the actual software itself. There are significant lacking capabilities of certain software, particularly when it comes to recognizing Black women's faces, but in general, differentiating between people of color and recognizing women is often difficult for many biometric services. There's also concerns around policing or technology access. For people who are applying for benefits, they may not have technology that can run the software. Their computers might not be up to date to the point that it can run the software, or they might not have access to phones with cameras, things like that. There are also security concerns. Often biometrics is recording things like our faces, our fingerprints, and the question is, what is being done with that data afterwards? Who has access to it? And are we protecting users when we're accessing that sort of information? Cool. So another form of identity proofing that has become increasingly popular is knowledge-based verification. So it's also known as KBV. And KBV is an identity verification method based on knowledge of private information associated with a claimed identity. So if I claim I am Simone Singleton, I can go through a KBV process of selecting information that is associated with Simone Singleton and saying whether or not it's true. It became increasingly popular as a response to security concerns during the pandemic. However, it's been in use for a long time before that. And in the private sector, you may have interacted with something like this, maybe to log into your bank or something like that. It's also often referred to as knowledge-based authentication or knowledge-based proofing. There's a lot of terms for it, but the key sort of words to look for are knowledge-based. It generally requires answering multiple choice questions about yourself. You can look over here to the right and see some examples of the type of questions you might be asked. And it's based off of information from your credit history, such as past addresses, information about car purchase, past cities of residence, things like that. Again, as with each of these methods, it's important that we consider the equity and security concerns. When it comes to equity, there are particular concerns for people that have limited or no credit history, or who have been on the receiving end of identity theft. So if I don't have a credit history, for example, maybe a person who's just never had a credit card or a younger person, there is no way for me to have information pulled from my credit history and successfully complete KBV. Or if I've been on the receiving end of identity theft, there may be information included in my credit history that I have no knowledge of and would not be able to successfully complete questions around. For all those audiences, a process like KBV can be very prohibitive and may require them to take other avenues to prove their identity that may either discourage them from accessing services or prevent them altogether from accessing them. There are also security concerns. There have been data breaches in the world, for example, the Equifax data breach. And in that case, information used in a process like KBV may not be as private as like the security measures suggest.
And I would just underscore that this is like not a recommended method of identity proofing, but it is still, as we'll talk a little bit more in our landscape overview of like how authentication and proofing currently show up in initial applications for benefits online. It is still very commonly used, but it is not recommended from a security standpoint, which I think is really important to keep in mind in addition to these really serious equity concerns.
Perfect. Thanks for adding that. Okay, cool. Next up, we have single sign-on, which you may be familiar with or have interacted with. It sits under authentication, so it's an authentication framework that allows the use of a single set of credentials to log into multiple related software systems. So for example, in the benefits space, this may be someone accessing a statewide single sign-on. The concept works in the way that authentication for one part of the system may automatically authenticate the user in other parts of the system. So I sign in wanting to access one part of the service, but by logging in and authenticating myself, I can access other parts of the system as well. There may be conflicting requirements or expectations for each system access. For example, if I'm going through a statewide single sign-on authentication, I may be doing it because I want to access Medicaid or SNAP, but a person who's doing something very different from that, like renewing their driver's license or submitting an application for a business license, may be accessing the portal in the same exact way. However, these are very different audiences with very different needs and may have access to very different information. So what might be workable for certain people may be a significant barrier for other people. This is a generalization, but typically the most restrictive requirements are applied, but this, again, might lead to access concerns.
And just piggybacking on that last piece with single sign-ons, I think we've encountered cases where a statewide single sign-on is maybe introduced and then applied to a benefits application, and so introduces new requirements around identity proofing that are transferred from that statewide single sign-on kind of authentication framework to a benefits application where they might not have previously been in play. But continuing to talk a little bit about authentication, so two-factor authentication, this is basically using two or more factors or authenticators to achieve your authentication. So this might look like using both a password and entering a one-time code sent to your mobile device via text, or entering a password and responding to a push notification from like an authentication app on your phone. I think something that's worth underscoring here is that having good multi-factor authentication can be really important from a security perspective, but it needs to be thought about in terms of who are the users of this service. Do the authentication methods that are in on offer or required for accessing this service, are they accessible to them? Do the users of this service have consistent device or email access? And then also from a security perspective, I think there's an important conversation to be had about the use of phishing-resistant authentication, which we can talk more about, but it's both a question of like, is it accessible to the people who you imagine to be or know to be your users? And also, is it working well from a security perspective? Awesome. So switching gears a little bit, we're going to talk very briefly about NIST, the National Institute of Standards and Technology, and why their work might matter for y'all. So NIST is a standards-making organization within the Department of Commerce. They work on a lot of different topics, but their special publication 863, Digital Identity Guidelines, details a risk-based process and technical requirements for managing digital identities. We thought it was important to talk about NIST today for a few reasons. So NIST's standards guidelines are most relevant for federal agencies, and states don't have to follow NIST standards, but NIST is the default standard for industry. And so many vendors that are working with state agencies or seeking to work with state agencies on identity proofing or authentication related topics will refer to how their products align with NIST standards. I think it's important to note that NIST itself does not do any accreditation of products that vendors produce. So if a vendor says they're NIST approved or certified, that is something to look into. There is a nonprofit association that does third-party review of identity proofing and authentication systems, Kantara, but that's not coming directly from NIST. Also, if your state agency, if you're having a conversation about identity proofing and authentication for your state's benefits programs, if your state agency says that they need to meet certain identity proofing or authentication requirements in terms of the NIST guidelines, it may also be worth exploring that and how that actually, where that's coming from for your state or a given program in your state. For example, California's unemployment insurance code specifically calls out NIST standards for identity proofing. But that may not be the case where you are. I also think it's worth emphasizing that in addition to kind of being aware of how these terms are being talked about both by vendors or state agencies, the NIST standards also are a framework for doing authentication and identity proofing securely and kind of at that like highest level. So if it is being used, thinking about those as guidelines that can be important reference points for doing this well. NIST is also in the process of updating their digital identity guidelines to further emphasize equity and access as well as privacy. Those draft guidelines will be open for public comment again this later this year. So there's an opportunity to help shape what those guidelines look like from whatever advocacy or benefits access perspective you bring. So we're going to talk a little bit more about some of the key terms that come up when we're talking about NIST standards. So I'll pass back to you, Simone.
Sweet, thank you. Cool. So we've given you a lot of information about digital identity and identity proofing and authentication, and it's useful for us to consider how we actually work through this information. How do we choose what approach we should take and what we should consider? NIST gives us a really useful concept of risk management. And risk management is the process of identifying, assessing, and addressing possible security risks. So there are a number of risks that are possible in the world. Some types of risks could include liability or policy violations, concerns around public image, the release or the unauthorized release of sensitive information, financial loss, concerns around personal safety. And there's also kind of a distinction to make, which is the risk to an individual versus the risk to an organization. So I, Simone Singleton, am accessing SNAP benefits, a portal in California. What are the risks to me as an individual by going through this process? And also, what are the risks to an organization like California or my county by going through this process? When we consider risk management, we are balancing the concept of risk and access But it's important that we prioritize equity and access while we're going through this process. So we don't want to be overly secure to the point that people can't get access to the things that they need, or we're preventing people from getting the benefits that they are eligible for. I'll pass it back to you.
Yeah, thanks. So this is going to be a pretty radical simplification of this concept, but we thought this was important to touch on very briefly. So within the NIST guidelines, there's a framework for assurance levels for identity proofing, authentication, and federation. In a basic sense, if we're thinking about different systems and services, if there's a higher level of risk, we might want to use a higher assurance level when we're doing our identity proofing or authentication to increase confidence in knowing who someone is, or that they're the same person returning to an account. So within the NIST guidelines, there are different levels of assurance levels for identity proofing, authentication, and federation that are meant to be selected based on a kind of risk management or assessment process that takes into account the organization, the individual, what are the specific risks, mission priorities. But I think the thing to keep in mind here are that there are levels of identity proofing and authentication that move from least to most stringent. Different services and systems are going to have different risks. And so identity proofing and authentication, if they're being used, should be tailored according to that. So it's not necessarily an either or. It might be a question of like levels or gradations of what are you doing in a given system.
Perfect. So when we're thinking about these levels or possibilities of being more or less stringent, something to consider is, in each of these levels, what are the equity concerns? And there are significant ones that I've already touched on, but I'll just have a moment to kind of put them in one place. So for knowledge-based verification, again, if a person has limited or no credit history, they will either have a lot of difficulty completing the process or will not be able to complete the process at all. And they may have to take alternative avenues that can be really frustrating for people or just lead them to not getting benefits at all. There's also the question around data. And I think like in the world, this is becoming an increasingly popular thing for us to think about. Like, what is happening with all this data that is being collected about us? Who has access to it? Where is it being used? So in the public benefit space, the question is, are we collecting unnecessary information about people? And when we are collecting that information, who stores it and who has access to it once proofing is completed? There's also a question around like client or user access that I kind of split up into three categories. The first is documents. There is a world where people would have to submit documents about themselves, such as IDs, or have access to documents in order to get through a process. So, for example, under knowledge-based verification, there may be questions asked about past addresses or past workplaces. I know I, as a person who have moved a lot, don't remember all of my addresses, sorry. And so if I didn't have access to the documents that actually have the addresses listed out, I may have difficulty completing the process. There's also concerns around technology access. So if I am submitting an online application, I may only have access to one form of technology and maybe doing it on my phone or doing it on my computer or doing it in a public library. And those technologies also might not be advanced enough or have software that's been updated and able to actually run whatever technology is needed to complete the process. There might also be language access barriers, and there are multiple ways to think about this. The first is the information in the process in plain language? Do I understand what's being required of me? Do I understand what's being asked of me? Also, do I understand where this service is getting this information about me? And there's also another branch, which is, if I'm accessing the service as a person who is using it in a language other than English, does the service translate? And if it does the translation make sense? And these are things that are important to consider because we have a very diverse audience of people that are accessing benefits. Also, as I touched on earlier, there is biometric bias. So biometric services may not be able to recognize certain groups of people, and this bias can lead to significant complications for a specific audience. Something I haven't really touched on, but I think is significant, is the psychological costs of a process like this. So personally, when I think about accessing public benefits, the priority for me is dignity. Like, is a person who's accessing benefits, do they feel dignified? Do they feel respected? Do they feel like they're being treated like a person when they're doing this process? And if a person is required to repeatedly prove who they are, repeatedly go through strenuous processes, that's not really a dignified experience, and it actually may imply some amount of distrust from the agency directed at the person trying to access benefits. There's also a component of surveillance that's often associated with things like biometrics, or the kind of possibly invasive questions that KBV might ask people. And surveillance is a concern, particularly for low-income communities of color, and again, might agitate that concept of distrust and really lower the dignity in an experience. And of course, there's a really significant consequence. We've seen this during unwinding. If I can't meet identity proofing requirements, or I can't authenticate myself through an account, how can I access services? People lose benefits, can't see their families when they can't access these services. Cool. So we're going to pause. I know that was a lot of information. Thanks for giving us your attention for that period of time. Are there any questions about anything that we've discussed so far? Feel free to come off mute, drop it in the chat, send Q&A. I'll wait like a minute, and if there aren't any questions, I'll keep it pushing.
I have a question, maybe now or later. I wonder if you could talk more specifically about Medicaid and the marketplace and CHIP and the online application and the real time and the data pinging with IRS and what kind of constraints that puts on states who might want to have a less onerous identity proofing process than they have.
Yeah, that's a good question. We can talk about that now. Jen, are you here? I can't see if everybody's here. But I can hop on that for right now. Hi, Jen.
Hi.
Yeah, go ahead.
Sure. Hi, Vicky. So the issue, what Simone referred to earlier as kind of the status quo, is that if a system is giving back to a client information from confidential data sources, then RIDP is required. And so that could be some sort of a, not just real-time eligibility, but giving information back to the client. So our records show that you're currently earning this much. Our records show that you're receiving Social Security for this much. Is that correct? It could also be, as some states have seen, that there's a notice in the online portal that contains information such as a budget that includes Social Security data. And because that information can be traced back to the federal data source, then identity proofing is required upfront. And so we see commonly in states like yours where there's vertical integration between the marketplace and Medicaid, and the marketplace system has more of that interactive approach than the traditional SNAP Medicaid application, then sometimes RIDP is required. So if that presents a barrier in your state, there are ways to look at, first of all, is it actually required? Is the system providing information that you need or that from these data sources? And is there an alternative? Could you remove that, first of all? Like, does that add value? You know, in the one state we're talking about with the notice, that's not really a big deal. So if you could find a way to suppress that notice or maybe not include that detail or provide a combined budget, not broken out by item, then that would take that element off the table and you wouldn't need RIDP. But if it turns out that that is integral to the whole system, then you want to look at how do you make it as accessible as possible, such as like having alternatives, like going to an in-person assister who could verify for you, or going into an office or something like that. But right now, Medicaid and the marketplace use something other than the NIST standards, where if that confidential information is returned to the person, identity proofing is required.
Sweet. Thanks so much for hopping in on that. Cool. any other questions? Anybody else? You'll have an more opportunities later on also to ask questions, so no pressure. Okay, cool. We are going to keep it pushing. Next up, I'm really excited about this. Elizabeth is going to walk us through some of the work that her and her team have done in this space, particularly as a landscape overview of what's going on in this world.
Thanks, Simone. Also, Teresa in the chat, all these acronyms, I totally hear you. We will keep working on demystifying the acronyms together. To get into some of this landscape overview, in late 2022 and early 2023, my team at the DBN, in collaboration with colleagues at Code Fair America, a shout out to Sarah and Danny, who are both here today, conducted research to document identity proofing and authentication practices in initial online applications for SNAP, TANF, MAGI Medicaid, WIC, childcare, and unemployment insurance across states and territories. On this slide, I have a QR code and a shortened link, which I will also put into the chat in case you want to access this information on your own. But we were interested in conducting this research because we had seen how during the pandemic, unemployment insurance programs rapidly rolled out new identity proofing requirements, like Simone mentioned. And it quickly became clear that those new identity proofing requirements were making it harder for eligible claimants to get through application processes, whether because they faced issues accessing identity documents, didn't have strong enough internet connection, were applying on mobile devices, or faced other kinds of language access issues. And so for us, seeing how quickly identity proofing had been rolled out in unemployment insurance programs and how it was impacting claimants, we really wanted to get a landscape understanding of how identity proofing and authentication was showing up across the public benefits ecosystem. And so in late 2022, we sought to address several research questions, and you can go to the next slide, Simone, including when and how do applicants need to create a login to apply for benefits online? What kinds of personal identifiable information are applicants required or requested to provide when applying online? When and how are applicants being asked to take active steps to prove their identities during an online application process? And what identity proofing methods are applicants being asked to use? For us, we were really motivated to do this work because we wanted to build understanding among practitioners working in and alongside government about what identity proofing and authentication looks like today, what it can actually achieve, and some of the inherent trade-offs. So to answer our research questions, we reviewed 158 combined and standalone online applications across these six programs. For unemployment insurance applications, we were relying on publicly available information from a mix of different sources. And we also had a data sharing agreement and data collection partnership with Code for America, as part of their benefits enrollment field guide, which facilitated our data collection for the other five programs. I just want to flag that this is very much a point in time research project. So we know that some states have made changes to their application since we originally collected this information, and we'll be making some updates to our data set later this spring. Also, given the research methods that powered this project, we know that there are things we couldn't access or find information on. So we always welcome feedback if you have information about your state's application. But overall, we think that some of the trends that we found are still very instructive, even if things have started to change a little bit in a few states. So you can go to the next slide. In terms of authentication of the online applications we reviewed, 75% require applicants to log in or create an account to start an application. We also found 31 applications using single sign-on options, which was interesting to us for some of the reasons we've already discussed in terms of single sign-on potentially making it easier to go from one government service in your state to another, but also potentially creating new requirements or obstacles for users. And then on this next slide, we can also see how requirements to include an email during a required or optional account process, account creation process might vary. So we saw applications for UI most often require an email address. This was a data point that we were interested in because guidelines from USDA's Food and Nutrition Service state that applications for SNAP cannot require users to submit an email address, since doing so would create an additional condition of eligibility. Importantly, this chart is showing email address requirements for both optional and required account creation processes. But we found 11 states that seem to require SNAP applicants to provide an email address. Moving to the next slide, and I am moving very fast because I really want us to get to our discussion with you all and our Jamboard, but happy to answer questions or go deeper on any of this during the session or offline. We found that around a third of the applications we reviewed require or prompt some type of active identity proofing steps as part of an online application process. This might not sound like a huge number, but like we said, the spread of these approaches during the pandemic for us suggests the potential for quick expansion into other programs if they experience new types of threat or perceived fraud. On the next slide, we can see the breakdown around identity proofing requirements by program. So something that we had suspected and confirmed in this research was that identity proofing requirements were most common in unemployment insurance online applications, with just over half requiring some type of active identity proofing steps to apply. Among the other benefit programs we looked at, identity proofing requirements or prompts were most common for applications that allow users to apply for MAGI Medicaid. We also were really interested to note that identity proofing methods really vary between unemployment insurance applications and other public benefits applications. So we found evidence at the time of our data collection that 22 labor agencies were using biometrics for identity proofing. So asking folks to upload images of their face and a photo ID, primarily through ID.me. But we did not find evidence that biometrics were being used for any identity proofing in other public benefits programs at this time. So when identity proofing is showing up in those other non-UI programs, typically seeing knowledge-based verification or KBV being the method. And then in doing our research on authentication and identity proofing practices, we were primarily focused on getting that landscape understanding, the what is happening. But we also observed several digital, what we call digital identity design patterns that are technology agnostic and which we believe may promote access and should be further explored and evaluated, including application processes that don't require account creation or identity proofing when you're submitting that initial application. Account creation processes that are optional with clear explanations about the benefits for opting out or opting in, online applications that let users opt out of online identity proofing with clear instructions, and also application processes that offer in-person identity proofing or verification pathways. I've included a couple examples on this slide here. So example, BenefitsCal, which makes account creation optional and clearly explains why you might want to have an account, as well as Colorado Peak, their application. And you can also find the full publication that outlines some of the DBN's point of view on this topic and some of the other examples that we found with the quick link that is on the slide or the QR code. I'm going to stop there and pass back to Simone. We'll just say again that this was a point in time research project. We think these trends are still really informative. We will be making updates. So if you're interested, stay tuned. If you have feedback on your state's entry, we welcome that. And I'm also super excited to hear from all of you in this discussion section, because I think this is really relevant to some of the ongoing work we're doing in the space.
As we're wrapping this thing up, the question to consider is what's actually happening in your state, and how to apply this is asking the question, what's happening? If there is identity proofing or authentication that's prohibitive, why is it being included? As Jen mentioned earlier, is it necessary or required? If not, we can remove that step. If it is necessary or required, how can we make it better? So can we reorder the process? Can we make it optional for people? Can we rephrase questioning in plain language? Or can we make sure that we're providing clear and easy in-person alternatives? An example for that would be like a trusted application assistor approving an ID in person. So these are just a few things to consider. And I'm really grateful. We're at time. I don't want to keep you over. Thank you so much for being here. I saw some questions in the chat. We will be sharing out, if you're subscribed, either with the center or with the DVN, we will be sharing out the recording for this and the PowerPoint. And we're working at the center getting some sort of landing page so you can access this and point people to it later. But that's the process. So in the meantime, thank you so much for your attention. Feel free to reach out to either me or Elizabeth in the future. And yeah, I hope you have a great day.